Welcome everyone to day four of the South by Southwest live stream. It's brought to you by the UK's Department for International Trade. I'm your host, Jimmy Conrad, and we're here on the floor at the Convention Center in Austin, Texas, to talk about and with British companies that are driving innovation in the tech space. And today's focus is going to be traditional arts, and they're merging with new media. And since you guys don't really want to hear from me, I mean, I could talk about it quite a bit. I've invited some of my friends. So over here to my left, Tom Higham. He's the creative director for Mediale. And we have Alex Whitley, who is the man, the myth, the legend, and the name behind the Alexander Whitley Dance Company. And then we have Lucy Dusgrave, who is the digital programmer for the theater, the Lowry, in Manchester.
Right. Yeah.
So thank you guys so much for your time, for coming in.
Thank you.
Appreciate
pleasure.
It.
Pleasure.
Okay. So first things first. You guys are all in the traditional arts. You have to embrace this new media that's happening, because a younger generation likes to consume their content in a different way. How do you go about doing that?
To me, new media and technology, it's not new. So media art and digital art is 30, 40, 45 years old, and technology being used in the arts more broadly is a centuries old. You know, the technology we're talking about now is VR, is interactive work, is all kinds of different screen-based media. But in the past, it might have been paint, it might have been clay. You know, it's just a tool. That's all it is.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to hate on technology, but technology potential is huge and increasing. And I think artists are at the forefront of innovation. It's a well-used, well-hammered term, but artists push the boundaries of what's possible with technology and with creativity. So I think it's crucial.
Okay, and Alex, for you, do you feel like this technology is a way to enhance your art, or do you feel like at times it can be limiting because you focus so much energy on what you're doing that you're like, oh man, now I have to do this as well? How do you see that?
I think, it places a different kind of strain on organizations, particularly small organizations. You know, my company's only 3 years old, and I have a wonderful producer who does a lot of the work, so I can be in the studio doing the creative stuff. But the requirements to have a social media profile, to be active on social media at the same time as being in the studio making stuff, and also planning for the various projects that we're doing, it's a strain, but there's opportunity there as well. I think the internet's really changed the dance world massively. Young people can see dance in a way that was impossible to do so when I was training as a dancer. You know, we had a few videos in our school library of a few dance productions.
If you're lucky.
Yeah, if you're lucky, exactly. And and now you can go onto YouTube and see, not only the history of Western dance traditions, like contemporary dance and classical ballet, but all sorts of dance styles from around the world. So it's doing a lot to inform the progression of the dance, of the art form itself, which I think is really exciting.
Now, Lucy, as he says, you're now opening yourself up to a whole new audience.
Yeah.
You have a lot at your disposal with the Lowry. You guys do a lot of things. How do you pick and choose what you want to showcase?
Sure. Well, we've got large galleries, large theatre spaces, small theatre spaces as well. So how to go through that? We do accept that some people will only have an interaction with us through the digital technology, and we're absolutely comfortable with that. It may be that they're never going to cross over into these cultural institutions. They may not see themselves as traditionally being like a theater or an opera or a dance audience, but if we can bring the work to them, that's their first point of contact. Then, if we're going into the worlds of people rather than expecting them to come to us, that's potentially where we've got the biggest gains. And that's, it's also, it's a responsibility we should have as well.
Yeah, and it's a challenge.
It
seems like a challenge you guys embrace.
Yeah, but I mean, we've all come up through sort of using this technology ourselves. Mm. I came up with photography, film, and followed the curve of what was happening in technology. We've all done that. So it's not like we operate in isolated little pods of the fantastic little world of dance, and we never go outside of that. It's very much, these are things we're using in our daily life, the phone, that computer you've got in your pocket, we've all got one. And that's where the public's already there, so we're just bringing it up to that level in terms of catching up with where the public are already there.
I think all of us on this mission, and all of the companies represented, we're completely open to, and we all take a sort of quite open and experimental approach with technology interacting with how we make the work, not just how we show people the work. So maybe 5 years ago or 8 years ago, technology was seen as more of a distribution channel for work. So don't mess with the precious art and use technology to distribute it more widely. But actually, I think what's much more interesting and much more exciting as an opportunity for us is to play with the technology and change the way we work with it, because it offers new opportunities. So.
Definitely.
Yeah, it's very much, it was used documentation-wise, wasn't it, initially? It was the same when they first put art on TV, and they just literally sat the camera there and went, here is art, you know, that's it. And we, you know, hopefully we'll be on that now. You're doing some of that stuff,
And I think there's a lot to be done to you know, inform the wider arts community and the funding community as to how digital technology can be integrated and be used in the art form, you know, across the different levels of operating. Like marketing is obviously the primary means to which it's being used, but you know, I've been incorporating interactive technology in my stage performances, so trying to bring something innovative and new to a, you know, an art form that's been around for a long time. But also in terms of how you can engage young people with educational tools, like using interactive technology. Well, I mean, for me as a choreographer, there's an amazing opportunity, I think, to use this kind of new technology that's emerging to engage young people in choreographic theory, which is often quite kind of complicated to explain in very kind of tangible and direct ways. You know, we've got all this motion tracking technology that's becoming more and more affordable.
And it has a lot of sort of gaming elements to it as well, but, you know, the kind of patterns.
To get people moving and to give them a very direct and tangible response to their actions is, you know, directly tapping into the essence of choreography in a way and what dance is. And so, you know, there's lots of really exciting ways I think it can be used, and we need to work hard as artists, I think, to really make it known how it can be applied in more creative ways.
I would say one of my favorite parts about new media is that you can try stuff, and because the attention spans are so short, there's a lot of trial and error there, and I think that's something positive that artists can embrace, because let's just see how it goes, and if it hits, great, and then you got something, but if it doesn't, nobody really saw it, right? Only a few people saw it, and you kind of tuck it away and go back to the drawing board. Do you feel like that's empowering to what
you're
doing?
Yeah, I think in terms of artists, have always experimented, they've always played with and pushed the boundaries or diverted and subverted the use of, whether it be technology or spaces and places. So this is nothing new in terms of artistic interpretation. What we're seeing more interesting now, I think, is rather than projects starting with, here's the artist creating their work, and now let's put some technologist or technology onto it. We're seeing much more collaborative, so it starts from point A, which is what you do, So we're actually crediting the creativity of the technologists, but also some of those are actually artists independently in their own right. They're working with across the art forms in terms of its different practitioners all coming together. And that way you get much more interesting experiments, but you might end up with something you didn't even think you were going to at the start, and that's where it becomes really interesting.
Now when you walk by or walk through, let's say, South by Southwest, do you see a piece of equipment, you're like, wait a second, I can do something with that.
Yeah.
I mean, do you feel like you get inspired when you walk through here?
Yeah, I think that there's an amazing sort of trickle down, maybe is the wrong term, but an example would be the Microsoft Kinect, which we've all worked with for many years now, right, in artistic creation. But when that was first released, it was hacked very, very fast by artists to use to make interactive performances, installations. Then Microsoft, in their wisdom, opened up the SDK to use that technology. But before that was released, that kind of equipment, an infrared motion tracking, cost you £6,000, £8,000, £12,000, $15,000, you know? So that then becoming available for £60 or $100 is kind of a massive shift, and it enables people to experiment much more with cutting-edge technology. And I think the relationship between art, industry-wise, the art sector and the technology sector is closer and closer, because I think they're both understanding what the other can do for them.
Absolutely.
Rather than it being the technology industry being this big established commercial sector and the art industry being publicly funded and not very commercially savvy, I think they're both understanding that artists can push the boundaries of the technology and technologists can benefit.
And do some good work for these big companies
exactly.
in taking their ideas and you know, showing them what more can be done with them, you know, thinking more creatively outside of just a marketing campaign to you know, show what the technology can do.
And critically as well. Yeah, I think that's a big role for artists with technology, is to oftentimes a friend of mine coined a term called means well technology. So a technology or an application will be released that fixes a problem, but it causes four others.
Yeah, right.
And unless you poke the boundaries of that technology, you might not have found those four problems before it maybe gets released on a large scale, causing massive problems. So artists often will take a critical approach to what's going on around them, and technology is no different. I think it's just another it's another material in our world that we're getting more access to. So.
Yeah.
Is there, for the sake of a contrast, do you feel an obligation to do new media for marketing purposes, or to make sure that you are reaching new audiences? It might not be something you guys really want to do deep down, but you understand that's how the game is played. Or is it really, I feel like I've maybe hit this already, but I want to at least give this part of the conversation some air to breathe, because I think it's interesting to see, all right, I'm passionate about this, I planted the seed here, this is why I actually want to grow, but I understand for this to get even bigger, I have to do this.
I think in terms of the UK art sector, you know, we've always had very much a kind of reaching out their approach, the idea of engaging people that are hard to reach or not traditionally seen as an audience for some of the work. It's not an issue for us as much as it might be in other countries. We do very definitely have that obligation in a way built into us by our sort of association to public funds.
Yeah.
But also, you know, it is something where it gets more interesting, because if you have a certain race class of person only ever seeing the work, it doesn't have the opportunity to expand as rapidly in terms of creativity compared to where you've got a whole cross-section diversity of people looking at things. So it should be our obligation. It's I can't remember which Greek person said it, but they always said that art is very much for the minorities, because they will then tease and play with the ideas of things, whilst the minority will accept the status quo. So it is, you know, it is something where, you know, you should be engaging people from across the diversities of things.
It came up on the panel Lucy and I were on yesterday of technology's not always a positive influence in an artistic project. So technology for technology's sake, I mean. So
yeah.
I think it always has to be, I know an incredible artist in Manchester in the UK who works with light and creates installations, performances, makes a lot of other very high profile artists look good. He doesn't have a website, doesn't have a Twitter handle, doesn't have a Facebook page, barely has an email address. He's working every day and he's incredibly respected in the community, but he doesn't want to put himself into that kind of almost marketing brand sense. He doesn't feel the need to. And that's fine, it works for him, you know? And I think it's easy to get carried away with sort of like, more technology is better because it's more, you know, and that growth mentality isn't necessarily
you lose
right.
Purpose, don't you?
Yeah.
Well, and I guess
yeah.
it depends on how you define success, because some people view it by followers and how many views, but for your friend, it seems like it's just the quality of work and being involved in a more meaningful way. So how do you balance that?
Yeah, it's difficult because there, you know, like Lucy's alluded to, there is a there's an obligation that we have as publicly funded artists to do this work. And you know, particularly in the dance world, where there's a very kind of established format for how dance organisations work in terms of their relationships to theatres, funders, and it's quite difficult to act outside of that model because it's so pre-established. And but there is there's a constraint around it. Yeah, particularly in the early stages, you know, there's this kind of catch-22 situation you get into where you need to. Have the resources to fulfill, you know, these requirements now, having your social media channels active, you know, having publicity in on, you know, on the web and in print and all these various things, and having the people and the resources, the financial resources to do that requires a lot. So you need to then get more funding to do that, and you know, there's all this work that goes on to facilitate the, or you know, perceivably facilitate the art. But it's actually the art somehow tends to be the latter consideration in that big mix
of
things.
We have a responsibility as well to, as arts organisations, I think all three of us share that responsibility of diversifying how we earn money. So as publicly funded, we're very lucky in the UK in comparison with the US with having the Arts Council and the huge investment into culture and art that we have. But we're constantly pressed, and rightly so, to diversify where we earn commissions from and sponsorship, and And if we, it would kind of be irresponsible for us not to try and reduce our reliance on public funding and try and appeal to more commercial sectors and to more different industries and articulate the value of what we do outside of our own networks, you know, so we're constantly having to sell in a sense, you know, and put out the right messaging and to the right audiences and in the right ways. So I think we all share that responsibility.
Yeah, and you know, the internet and online platforms are opening up new possibilities and new channels of not only presenting work, but getting people to fund the work as well. You know, like Nowness, for example, has a, you know, 4 million online audience. Or something now, like that.
And for the people that might be unaware, you guys have said public funding in the Arts Council a few times. Yeah. Yeah. Can you guys give some background as to what they're doing for you and their involvement and how you guys work together?
The Arts Council. Yeah. Did a couple of years
in
there.
Part one, part two, part three.
So there is public money. It comes from a mix of lottery money as well as money from the Department of Culture, Media and Sport. It's divvied up from the government through Arts Council England, which is the body that then distributes it across England. And you either apply for it on a project by project basis, which is called Grants for the Arts in the UK, or you are a national portfolio organisation. So there you will have I think we're just going into 4-year agreements, so 4 years of public funding. It's at a rate that goes across those. It allows you to plan, it allows you to develop, and there is, you know, it can be a very small scale to a large scale organisation in that. And you can also be an individual to go in for Grants for the Arts rather, which is very unusual, because normally you can't go in for public funding. So it gives that real flexibility in terms of the UK scene and in terms of people being able to come in for small amounts as well as larger amounts. It just enables a very kind of democratised approach to it. And you know, obviously there's competition, not everybody can secure what they want, it's really difficult. And I've worked in small as well as large organisations, so it really varies your experience of what that is. I find now working in a larger organisation, ironically, even though there's obviously an institution there, I find more freedom. Because somebody else is worrying about the finance, about the wages, about the health and safety.
And you've got longer term timelines, right?
Yeah. It's great, isn't it? I mean, you work at MIF as well. And it just enables you to, and you've worked with SAD as well. So it just gives you that flexibility to kind of be under an umbrella where you can then diversify out from there.
Now you talk about the freedom. How much risk do they give you since you're publicly funded? Or how much risk do you feel like you can take?
Good,
and it seems like, from what I've heard off camera, that the Arts Council is very supportive in your vision. But at the same time, as you said earlier, there's still a balance of making sure you're...
It's difficult for them, though. I mean, I think we were discussing this a lot yesterday with some people who used to work at the Arts Council, like you see, and some people who still do. I think it's important for people to understand how it is on the other side of the fence, because they have a national remit and all different art forms, different scales and types of organisation. So they fund the English National Opera or Barbican or you know, the South Bank, but also then fund individual projects that Alex might do or that I might do, and that'll range from, you know, tens of millions for the National Opera to £15,000 for one particular project. So it's very hard for them. It's a horrible job, I'm sure, to figure out how that portfolio sits, but the experimentation is, I think they will often sort of encourage organisations to be a bit more business-like and to move towards that diverse income portfolio and a more sustainable way of working. And major theatres like the Lowry, they have to be commercially viable entities, you know? So they have to hit the bottom lines of certain things. So the experimentation can reduce in that, right?
Yeah, it makes risk-taking harder when you're working more to a commercial model. I think it's... calculated risk taking when you're applying to the Arts Council, you know, because you want to both be seen to be innovating and doing, you know, new things and bringing fresh ideas to whatever art form you're working in, but also you've got to fulfill criteria. You need to make sure that, you know, you're getting bums on seats in a theatre, and so
it's responsibility to where the money's coming from.
Exactly.
Well, from everything that I've heard, I want to move to the UK and apply for a grant for the Arts Council. They seem pretty cool. So we can talk off camera about that. I'll get somebody to come. Okay, Mediale, tell us a little bit about what you're working on right now and how you can inspire the rest of us.
Okay, so York, the city of York in the north of England, is just been nominated or designated as a UNESCO City of Media Arts. So
congratulations.
Thank you very much. So that UNESCO designation is a great honor. It's a great responsibility. And one of the major projects that was in the application to become a UNESCO city was founding a biennial media arts festival of large scale. So the UK doesn't really have, it certainly doesn't have a major media arts event, a major media arts biennial, and there are several around Europe and in the US, but we're looking to build a quite large scale, multi-partner, multi-art form, media arts in a very broad term, art and technology event. It's scheduled for October 2018. We're currently building partnerships and fundraising, etc., to try and make it as big and impactful as we can. But York's a particularly interesting place because it's for anybody that's been there, it's beautiful. Mm. It's a kind of medieval town, beautiful heritage, lots of museums, lots of incredible.
So I assume we have the end.
But it's even more interesting then as an opportunity and as a context for technology-based work. So it doesn't have a lot of white cube galleries, it doesn't have a lot of black box theatres, but it has some of the most beautiful, unique contexts and stages for different kinds of work. So a lot of the work that we will be presenting will be newly commissioned for and in the place that we're presenting it. It will be very international, connecting with the other UNESCO cities of media arts, and film, music, installations, visual art, theatre, the lot. So that's the plan.
Sounds incredible, and still 18 months out.
Yeah, we've lots to do.
Lots to do. And then Alex, how about you? What's the latest with the dance company? And
I'm currently
now and in the
future? Well, I'm touring a piece I made last year called Pattern Recognition, which was a collaboration with digital artist Memo Atkin.
Go and see it if you can.
Yeah. That was a work that's working with a motion tracking system and 8 moving lights that accompany 2 dancers on stage. And the whole piece is built around the interaction between the lights and the dancers.
So really quick about that idea, where does that come from, and at what point do you say, I need to bring somebody else in to help enhance it?
This piece is kind of a development of a previous work I made in 2014 with Marshmallow Laser Feast. Robin here is from Marshmallow Laser Feast, and Memo used to also work with them. That was the first piece I'd made incorporating interactive technology. I've been interested in technology all my life. I think I grew up in a kind of a techie household. My dad always had the latest Apple computers coming out.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Not to say your dad's that old.
He is. Absolutely. Yeah. He's a Newton, I think. I guess as I've developed my own practice, I've enjoyed being able to incorporate my my life interest into the art form that I've also kind of grown up in. At a time when technologists have been developing really interesting systems which have a lot of relevance to what I do. These motion tracking systems are incredibly sophisticated in how they're using technology to bring a new kind of visual landscape. And I think choreography provides a really rich source for these interactive systems. And I think that, for me, there's a lot of interest in how this is really kind of expanding the field of choreography. It's extending the body into a different sphere, essentially. You're taking movement data and representing it in a new media, in a way. And it's for me, that's hugely exciting in terms of an art form that's always was traditionally been confined to the human body and its form and capabilities. That there's new terrain to be explored. And new relationships as well to be explored between what how we see a moving body in relation to some other form of motion in digital media. So it's a long-term interest of mine that I've been exploring in this kind of series of pieces, and pattern recognition is the most recent one of those.
You did something in 2014, you did something now.
Yeah.
Is there a third? Is there a
trilogy coming? There's a new piece coming in June of this year, actually.
Okay, wow.
There's a trailer for it around the corner.
Yeah. It's a piece called 8 Minutes, which is the time it takes light to reach the Earth from the sun. and I've been working with a space science centre in the UK called the Rutherford Appleton Laboratory. I've been working with solar physicists there, and so this piece is exploring
bringing science into
the physics.
Yeah, okay, hashtag respect for that.
Yeah, that's
nice.
Yeah.
Okay, and then Lucy, Lowry, what are you guys working on right now?
Yeah, well, we're spending about £1 million a year on our contemporary art program. The digital is very much embedded and ingrained across that, so it's the indoor, the outdoor stuff that's happening. For us, we're working on gallery exhibitions, commissions in the theatre spaces, presentations on stage. We've got the outdoor. We're also the only consistent commissioner of the last 5 years of commissioning large-scale outdoor digital works. So for us, the importance of being able to continually commission as well as actually present, but also be commissioning in the UK, is really important in terms of digital art and creativity around those ideas. So we're really proud of the work we've been doing. We're probably about 5 years in now. We've had work before that, but this has very much got a strong direction now in terms of the work I'm leading on with the presentations. And it's lovely as well, because it's a very international field that we all deal in. So the idea that we have this kind of a dialogue constantly with artists from across the world, and we worked with Alex before, we're working with Marshmallow Laser Feast at the moment. There's just a lovely plethora of talent there in terms of what the Lowry's doing, but also our faith in that this should be part of the mainstream programme. This is not a minority, a separate thing that should exist as its own definition. It should be part of mainstream audience experiences when they're coming to see culture, or when we're placing it into public spaces as well.
I think one of the things I would want to touch upon with regard to this, what you're saying, and then real life. It seems like in a world of divisiveness, in the art space, there's a lot of collaboration. I think that's a beautiful thing. And technology allows us to bring that even further, because you can be exposed to so many different people all over the world. How many touch points have you seen now because of your technology and embracing it, of reaching an audience that's a little bit farther away?
Definitely. I mean, it's one of those things, you know, I think we've all had experience of this where we're getting responses that are international to the work as well. And for us, the progression to keep expanding that is really key. That's where we really want to see the expansion, and we're wanting to see the engagement creatively by artists as well. Definitely.
And then for you, Alex, does somebody reach out to you? You thought never in a million years. Because of technology, because of what I'm doing, because I'm pushing boundaries, and people are now being exposed to it.
Yeah.
All right, maybe I will do something.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, people come across my work, you know, in the Far East or in the States even. We've toured to places that I think previously, you know, we wouldn't have if it wasn't for the internet, if it wasn't for having a website and people just being able to stumble across my work by Googling something. So it's definitely changing the way that we, you know, arts organisations can be discovered, and hopefully, you know, building new markets around the world for the work, which is, you know, it's important that the work we're making is seen and represented within the UK. But for me, it's also really important that we're getting out there and showing the kind of innovation that's happening in the UK further afield. So
it's global, isn't it?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think it's the same. It's a really important moment for there's a whole group in the UK, I think, or a generation of artists and technologists who are working in this field, and really we're lucky in the UK. I think we've got a real an environment, and there are clusters in a few of the cities in London, in Manchester, in Birmingham, in Newcastle, of creative technology expertise that's really quite rare, and it's getting out and about across the world. I mean, we're here now, right? But I think that the value there is seen by the technology industry as much as it's seen by the cultural industry. So Robin's company, Marshmallow Laser Feast, have a number of technology partnerships. So they'll receive equipment before it's ready for market to test it and to prototype with it and to actually feedback to the major tech companies what the real potential that maybe they haven't even seen in what they've made. And I think we're getting more and more to the state where I was working in a previous job in the future cities and urban design world, which really is starting to understand the impact and the engagement of participatory technology and art and participatory design and interactive work. So these artists and technologists, there's a big grey area, and we're all happily sitting in the middle of that grey area.
And also, you know, the great thing that I've enjoyed is discovering artists around the world that I've been able to collaborate with as well. You know, it's about how you can build networks and relationships across the art forms. And the great thing about dance is that it draws in so many different art forms, and I'm always on the lookout for, you know, new potential collaborators. So to be able to, you know, to see the work that's being made around the world, and, you know, exciting things that people are doing, and to
it's funny you say that, because I guess I've been asking questions about how you are being received to others, but ultimately you could be identifying talent as well at the Lowry.
Yeah,
you're like, hey, wait a second, I found this one website, this person is good, maybe we should hook them in.
We find that, you know, the more collaborative people are, the age of competition is just very cul-de-sac in its approach. You know, if you're going to sit there and just be competitive with others, it's not really going to help those experiments artistically. That you're missing out on the idea of what we can do through a shared brain approach to things, which is fantastic. That's where you really are being much more faithful to the art and where it can actually explore itself.
I could talk about this kind of stuff with you guys all day, but unfortunately we are out of time. So I'm going to start with you guys. Just tell us a little bit about where people can find you and explore what you're all about.
So for me, if you go onto cityofmediaarts.com, you'll be able to get more of my contact details and get in touch. My website is tomhigham.net. It's all on there too. But yeah, we're looking for partnerships. We're looking for commissions, co-commissioners. So yeah, get in touch.
Alex?
You can go to my website, alexanderwhitley.com. There's information there about my past productions, my upcoming production, 8 Minutes, which is going to premiere at Sadler's Wells on June the 27th.
Right.
So, and then we'll be touring that nationally and internationally from September onwards. So we're looking for venues to tour the work to, you know, particularly outside of the UK. I'm really keen to bring the work over to the States. I'm working with an LA-based composer, so I'm hopeful that the work will get out to LA at some point in the near future.
And good luck with that. And Lucy?
TheLowry.com, in terms of website, but call us, get in touch with us, come and visit us as well. Come and have a talk to us in terms of ideas you've got. We're always interested in where we can take things, where we can go to the next place. We have festivals, we have presentations, all those kind of things. There'll be a way in which people can come and engage with us. So we're very much open for business.
Thank you again for your time.
Thank
you guys for watching. And remember, our stream tomorrow, our last stream from South by Southwest, is happening at 10:30 a.m. local time. So on behalf of UK's Department for International Trade, I'm Jimmy Conrad, and I thank you for watching.